Well, good morning, friends, and a warm welcome to worship on this Remembrance Sunday, a day when we remember those who have given their lives for the peace and freedom that we enjoy today. Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So we begin our worship today by singing a hymn that holds so much meaning on a day like today. On this Remembrance Sunday, we sing, O God, our help in ages past. Continue to worship God in prayer. Let's pray. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Almighty God, our loving Heavenly Father, as we gather on this Remembrance Sunday, we echo the words of the psalmist who says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. You, our God, are our refuge and our strength. In you we find shelter and safety. You are our Redeemer, and we thank you for every memory that we have of your goodness, kindness, and love toward us. We praise you and thank you for the cross of Jesus Christ, your Son, and for the way it reminds us of his sacrifice for the sin of the world, thanking you that in a world torn apart by violence and despair, you breathe peace and hope and life. Today, as we remember the cost of conflict and war, we give thanks for the freedom that we enjoy. And we remember with gratitude and humility the sacrifice and bravery of those who paid the price for that freedom in the First and Second World Wars and in the conflicts that have followed. We think today also of those who serve in our armed forces, who around the world put their lives at risk in the hope of protecting the people of this and many other countries. seeking to make the world a more just, peaceful, and better place to live. Lord, as we pray for peace in the world today, may we reflect upon our own thoughts and attitudes, our words and our actions, and consider whether we reflect the love, grace, mercy, and peace of Christ to all whom we meet. And may your Holy Spirit work graciously within our hearts and our minds, that we might more fully live and act as the people of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Old Testament reading is from Micah chapter 6. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted Lord? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Would the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Our second reading is from John chapter 15. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my command, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this, so my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Love each other. Amen.
Darkness, longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ, be through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church gathered today. Longing for food, many broken for others, shared until all are fed. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church gathered today. Shelter, many are homeless, longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church gathered today. Many the gifts, many the people, many the hearts that yearn to belong. Let us be servants to one another, making your kingdom.
Sunday, we are thinking about heroes. I'm sure we all have them or have had them at some time in our lives. In my boyhood, they were always cowboys, like the Range Rider and the Lone Ranger. In more modern times, the media is always talking up various individuals as heroes from all kinds of fields of activity. They may be sports people, like Lionel Messi or Novak Djokovic. They may be film heroes, such as John Wayne or James Bond. They could be TV stars, like David Suchet as Poirot or Sir David Attenborough. While in music, we have heroes such as the Beatles and Elvis Presley. Usually these folk are regarded as heroes because they are famous, they are celebrities. They excel in their chosen spheres of activity. They are looked upon as role models, and not least, they are often quite wealthy. Nowadays, we also have superheroes. These are characters with extraordinary powers. They have usually appeared first of all in Marvel comics, and now they populate TV and films. Superheroes like Spider-Man, Captain America, the Guardians of the Galaxy, and the Incredible Hulk. They're not real people, of course, but are regarded as heroes because of their unusual abilities, which they use in fighting against super criminals and in overcoming the forces of evil. Strangely, the area in which heroes are less well known today is in the field of warfare. As you go into Dunblane from Stirling, you'll see a signpost stating Birthplace of James Palmer Huffen, VC. I wonder how many people know who this person is, or what he did to be awarded this nation's highest and most prestigious award for valour. Again, if you look closely at the local war memorial, you will find the name of a Bannockburn man, Sergeant John Stewart of the 5th Scottish Rifles, Cameronians. After his name are the letters MM, which stand for Military Medal. This decoration is awarded for, quote, acts of gallantry and devotion to duty under fire. I wonder how many people remember John Stuart or his heroic acts. Heroes of the two world wars, and indeed the many wars thereafter, tend to be pretty anonymous. That may be because such heroes appear to see themselves as just ordinary people. It just so happens that they have done something extraordinary on a particular occasion. If any of you have a member of your family who won a wartime award for gallantry, you will know that these extraordinary things are rarely mentioned by that person, if at all. Those who went and still go into battle are indeed usually ordinary people, coming from the farms and factories, shops and offices, homes and families just like ours, but who offer their lives in order to serve their country, to fight a threat to the safety of those same families and friends. They are all, whether they receive a medal or not, real heroes. Probably the most honoured and most celebrated British hero of all time is actually unknown, the one who lies in the tomb of the unknown warrior in Westminster Abbey. The idea for this began in 1916, when an Anglican clergyman serving on the Western Front, the Reverend David Railton, spotted a grave in the back garden of a house in France. Planted on the grave was a cross on which were written the words, "An unknown British soldier." This is what Railton wrote at the time. "How that grave caused me to think. I thought and thought, what can I do to ease the pain of father, mother, brother, sister, sweetheart, wife and friend? Quietly and gradually, there came out of the mist of thought this answer, clear and strong. Let this body, this symbol of him, be carried over the sea to his native land." 4 years later, Railton proposed to the Dean of Westminster Abbey a nationally recognised grave for an unknown warrior. Having been given the go-ahead by the King and the Cabinet, the idea caught the public imagination. The selection process had to be carried out with great sensitivity and indeed secrecy. The unknown warrior was chosen from 4 British servicemen whose bodies were dug up from the 4 main battlefields on the Western Front: the Aisne, the Somme, Arras and Ypres. These bodies were brought to the Chapel of St. Paul near Arras on the night of 7th November 1920. They were laid on stretchers, each covered with a Union Jack, in front of the Brigadier General in charge of British forces in France and Belgium. Blindfolded, he laid his hand on one body, and that became the unknown warrior. It could have been anybody, an aristocrat, a farmer, a factory worker, an unemployed person, a boy, a saint, a sinner. The point was that the nation might honour him without distinction of rank, birth or service. The fact that the identity of the soldier was unknown meant that he could represent all members of the British Armed Forces who had died in the war. The body was carried back to Britain with full dignity and honour. Firstly, by the French cavalry to the harbour at Boulogne. There, the coffin was taken aboard HMS Verdun and was escorted across the Channel by 6 battleships. On the morning of 11th November 1921, the unknown warrior began the journey to his final resting place, drawn on a gun carriage of the Royal Horse Artillery to the sound of a 19-gun salute, which was usually reserved for the funerals of field marshals. At the newly unveiled cenotaph in Whitehall, The cortege was greeted by King George V himself and by other members of the royal family. At 11 o'clock, there was a 2-minute silence, and the body was brought into Westminster Abbey, passing through a guard of honour of 100 holders of the Victoria Cross. And in the abbey itself sat 100 women who had lost husbands or sons in the Great War. The coffin was buried near the great west door of the abbey, with soil brought from the battlefields of Europe. And forever after, every formal procession into the abbey, be it a royal marriage or a special service of any kind, has to pass it and acknowledge it. Treating that unknown warrior with the highest honour imaginable was a deep act of faith. That faith which Paul spoke of when Jesus Christ died and gave himself to each one of us. The unknown warrior represents all those who gave their lives in all wars. This unknown warrior is honoured, not because of his personality, not because of his rank in society or in uniform, not because of his achievements, not even because of his bravery, but because he was known only to God, infinitely precious in his sight and worthy of honour. Today, more than 60 countries have war memorials housing the remains of an unidentified soldier. The word hero appears only 6 times in the Bible, and not once does it appear in the New Testament. Perhaps that is because being fully committed to following Jesus may have an element of heroism to it. After all, the Gospels give lots of warnings of what will happen to those who become followers of Christ. Jesus said, "Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me." In an increasing number of countries of the world, whether it be North Korea or Nigeria, India or Iran, it is the case that Christians are being persecuted for their faith. According to the charity Open Doors, which monitors these trends, last year, around the world, over 5,500 Christians were killed for their faith. More than 2,000 churches were attacked, looted, or forcibly closed. And around 140,000 people were displaced from their homes or countries for faith-related reasons. In many places, it does indeed take a great deal of heroism to be a Christian. Indeed, heroism and discipleship, it can be argued, share at least 2 fundamental characteristics. The first is service. Members of the armed forces, as well as many civilians, were called in time of war to serve their nation. Discipleship involves giving service to God by witnessing to our Lord in our lives and in meeting the needs of others. In our Old Testament reading, the prophet Micah states clearly what God requires of his people: to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And this has become a key example of Christian service in a nutshell. To do justly, in other words, to act fairly towards others and to treat them as you would want to be treated. To love mercy, that is to demonstrate loving kindness to others and to give them the same degree of compassion that God has given to you. And to walk humbly with your God, to journey through life recognising God as our Father and Creator in meekness and humility. Notice that these three steps all involve actions: doing, loving, walking. They are not just vague intentions. God calls us to active service in his name. The second characteristic is sacrifice. Above all, the observation of Remembrance Sunday is to remember those who gave their lives for others. Not just the loss of life, but also the long-lasting physical and mental wounds that veterans and their families continue to bear long after war is over. As the words in the Act of Remembrance say, when you go home, tell them of us and say, we gave our tomorrow for your today. In our New Testament reading, Jesus describes the measure and quality of his love for his friends, a love that is complete and surpassing greatness, a love that he showed by willingly sacrificing his own life on the cross. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. While this refers to the ultimate sacrifice, we as Christians are also called to sacrifice all aspects of our lives when we become friends of Jesus. Our time, our abilities, our energies, and our resources. And it is spelled out unambiguously in John 15, how we became Christ's friends. You are my friends, said Jesus, if you do what I command you. This then is what I command you, through service and sacrifice, love one another. Amen.
We're going to have in this stage a 2-minute silence as today we remember past wars, those who fought in them, those who lived through them, those who died in them. We pay respect to their memory. We express our gratitude for the sacrifices they have given for our freedom and the freedom of others. Remembering too those involved in current conflicts. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
History can inspire us or trap us. Walls can protect or divide. Words can encourage or inflame. Power can free or destroy. Touch can comfort or violate. Peace can be shared or withheld. Gracious God, on this day which we set aside to remember those who have suffered and been sacrificed in wars of the past, our thoughts inevitably turn to current conflicts where danger, violence, destruction and death are still daily realities for so many people. And so we bring before you this morning those who have been injured or disabled through war, those who have lost homes and security through conflict, those who have lost relatives in wars, those who continue to face danger and take risks for peace, those, especially children, caught up in current conflicts, refugees, and all those in need of aid and medical help. God of encouragement and Saviour of the despairing, comfort those who remember past sacrifices and guide us in building a just and peaceful community for all. We pray for the divided peoples of the world, that leaders, governments, and each one of us may use our resources, our opportunities, and our lives in the service of reconciliation, both for the sake of future generations and in obedience to our Saviour, who said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." Heavenly Father, our own daily needs and concerns seem trivial compared to those of the people of Gaza, Israel, and Ukraine. But we bring them before you anyway, confident that you are interested in all your children. Some of us worry about our health. Some of us worry about money. Some of us worry about a relationship that has broken down, perhaps with a family member. Some of us worry about mistakes we have made in the past. And some of us worry about the future. Lord, we bring all these concerns to you, asking that you will give us what we need, whether that be comfort or healing, forgiveness or courage, assurance or a surprising new development in our lives. Lord Jesus, you understand what it's like to be human. Take our prayers for ourselves, for others, and for reconciliation and peace in the world, as we bring them to you now, in your name. Amen.
True faith in you.
consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Darkness, only light, and where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never speak so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with. Consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness,
well, thank you to Kenneth for leading us in our remembrance today, and to John for prayer, and to Mary for the readings. And thank you for joining us. Go into the week ahead with a heart that grows in hope and a life that shines Christ's light. Go to love, to reconcile, to bring peace. And may the blessing of God rest upon you now and forevermore. Amen.